a couple of weeks ago on this channel, we talked about the traveling head of Oliver Cromwell. Now, of course, Oliver Cromwell is associated with the English Civil War that happened in the 1600s, where the people were starting to stand up for their own rights and waged war against the royalists or the monarchy. Now, if you watch that episode, you know that King Charles I was executed by beheading on the 30th of January in 1649. King Charles I's execution not only put the ruling of the government into the hands of the Puritans, but also formed a rather strange little cult. A cult that is still here to this day. But before we go any further, you know what to do. Please leave us a like and give us a subscribe. Again, thank you so much to all of our patrons. We have a few new patrons here on this channel and one new producer. Her information will hopefully be available for you guys next week. And as always, thank you again to Tiffany Monroe, one of our producers here at Esoteric Atlanta, who is a Reiki master here in the city. If you would like to get into contact with Tiffany regarding her services, her email address is listed down below. Welcome to Esoteric Atlanta. My name is Bryce. Today we are going to talk about the cult of King Charles I, the martyr. I posted on the community tab that we have been having some internet issues. I understand that this is happening all over the United States right now. We are experiencing rolling blackouts. I do personally believe that this has to do with NASARA that's going to start here in America first and then eventually branch its wings to the rest of the world, becoming just SARA. So it's not necessarily a bad thing, but I do know that it's caused some frustration for a lot of people. We at Esoteric Atlanta, we're gonna keep going, bringing you 3 to 4 videos a week. Just keep pushing through. If the internet does get cut, which that might happen, there might be some blackouts happening where they do cut the internet and cut cable and cut the media, don't panic. It's all gonna be okay. There will be an emergency broadcast system. But until then, like I said, we're just gonna keep going. I am also working on getting my awesome friend Anna down in Brazil on this channel. There's a topic that I really want her to talk about that's happened in Brazil, a current event that very much goes with what a lot of us are aware is happening right now. So I'm working on getting her on the channel, doing like a Zoom call with her so she can talk to you guys about what she knows. She has an awesome truther channel. Some of her videos are in English, some of them are in Portuguese, but if you want to check out her channel, I will put a link down below as well. All right, so let's talk about this cult that is based on King Charles I, who, yes, again, is one of my ancestors. I think that's why it makes me laugh. So King Charles I has come up in a couple of our videos. Like I said in the intro, we talked about him with Oliver Cromwell's traveling head, and Oliver Cromwell is one of the reasons why King Charles I lost his head. And we also talked about King Charles I on our episode around Grey Friars. I'm gonna put a link to both of those episodes down below in the description box if you want a refresher to look at those perspectives on this king. But for us to truly understand how King Charles I went from a tyrant king to a martyr to having a cult revolve around his life, then we have to go back, like way back to the Protestant Reformation. Once more, I apologize if you can hear all the sounds going on outside. Again, this has been a crazy year and I cannot control those sounds. So I hope that they're not gonna bother you too much. So around 500-ish years ago, Europe went through the Protestant Reformation. Basically, a lot of people were learning how to read and write and realized that the Catholic Church was tricking them and not really teaching them what was in the Bible. You had people like Martin Luther in Germany, John Calvin, you had the Huguenots in France, and in England, you had the Anglicans. The Anglicans were a little bit different than the other sects of the Protestant faith popping up all around continental Europe. This is because the Protestant Reformation took hold of the English government with King Henry VIII. I think we can safely say that King Henry VIII didn't care about Protestantism for its spirituality or its connectiveness to God. Instead, King Henry VIII formed the Anglican Church of England to simply get rid of the Pope. You see, King Henry VIII wanted to divorce Catherine of Aragon and marry Anne Boleyn, although the Pope wasn't going to let that happen. But seeing that King Henry VIII was a firm believer in the concept of divine right, he established that the Pope had no control over his country of England. So basically, the Church of England was like Catholic light. Basically, the seven sacraments were still there. They were still very much practicing what would be a Catholic version of faith, just without the Pope. Now, the king, King Henry VIII, was not only the head of the government of England, but he was also head of the church. On a side note, King Henry VIII's decision to do this would cause a domino effect of multiple events happening. It would cause Elizabeth I to have to cut off Mary, Queen of Scots' head, who by and by was King Charles I's grandmother. It would also cause controversy between his son Edward and his daughter Mary, Bloody Mary, because after Edward died, he didn't want his sister Mary on the throne because she was a Catholic, and so he left it to his cousin Jane, who ended up getting her head chopped off by Bloody Mary, who then tried to like burn all these Protestants at the stake. It just caused a whole bloody mess everywhere. But the whole point was that the Church of England ran very similar to the Catholic Church, except the monarchy was the head of the church. Even to this day, we have the monarch of Queen Elizabeth II is technically the head of the Church of England. Again, I don't actually believe Elizabeth II is still alive, but that's just my opinion. All in all, Anglicanism, a lot like divine right, is based off of the will of the king. Again, this goes back to our Grey Friars episode, where the Presbyterians of Scotland did not want King Charles I to dictate their relationship with God. Again, the Presbyterians of Scotland were very much following the Protestant faith as well as like the Puritans, whereas the Anglican Church of England was more of a political church. Now, King Charles I would not go on to be officially labeled a martyr until his son was restored to the throne after Oliver Cromwell died. Now, to truly understand how he became a martyr, we have to just briefly review what happened in court. Now, again, please refer back to our Oliver Cromwell episode if you want a more detailed analysis of the English Civil War. For this episode, we're just going to start with the trial. So the trial started on January 20th of 1649. King Charles I had been charged with treason, tyranny, and murder. Now, the only problem with trying a king at this time was that there was no court, there was no authority that was higher than the king. Again, please remember the concept of divine right. So needless to say, as King Charles I was brought into the court, he had a sense of arrogance about him. Even though he had tried to escape twice and had been under house arrest for a while during the war, he was still very arrogant because after all, he was the king. Under what authority did these commoners have the right to try him? At this point, the House of Commons had decided that they had supremacy and that they could try the king for treason and tyranny and murder. This might seem a little dodgy, as our British cousins might say, because it had never been done before. Now, to understand the controversy of this trial, we have to look at John Bradshaw, who was the person who oversaw the trial like a judge. Now, John Bradshaw wore a bulletproof helmet because he feared he would be assassinating for trying the King of England. Now, as I said, the House of Commons had decided that they had supreme power and could bring charges against King Charles I. Now, the House of Lords, on the other hand, had rejected this trial. We can understand that. They were more royalist. They were more loyal to the monarchy. There was absolutely no precedence of this happening before. No king of England had ever been tried or executed by his own people, maybe by some of his cousins, but not his own people. Well, John Bradshaw decided that the House of Commons that represented the people of England held that authority over the ruling monarch. As you can probably see, as we spoke about with the English Civil War, this is the beginning of a worldwide revolution where the people are starting to take their power. No longer are they subservient to this ruling group of people. This is the basis of the American Constitution, a constitution that's heavily under attack right now. The ruling elite still want to control us and they want to take away our constitution when our constitution says that we the people are the bosses, that we should not fear our government, but rather our government should fear us. We see this in King Charles I's trial. Now, for multiple days, the same circus happens over and over and over again. The king is brought into the courtroom and he says, "By what authority do you have the right to charge me?" And John Bradshaw says, "By the right of the people." And then he claims he represents the people as the king. And it's this constant going back and forth. After exhausting few days, they would always usher King Charles I out of court, where half of the crowd would be chanting "God save the king," while another half of the crowd would be shouting "Justice, justice, justice." This circus finally got to the point where John Bradshaw had to declare that King Charles I was in contempt of court. This is a term we still use in our court system today. However, back then, it meant that King Charles I was not going to be present for the rest of his trial. The trial would move on without him. And of course, we know the result. King Charles I was found guilty of treason, tyranny, and murder. And murder because of the English Civil War and all the people who lost their lives. They felt like he had started the English Civil War because of his blatant tyrannical practices against his own people. I can kind of agree, seeing what we're going through right now. And he was executed on January 30th, 1649. Again, his children and his wife went into exile and the Puritans ruled the country for a short time. Almost immediately after Charles's execution, we saw people viewing Charles as somewhat of a martyr. He wasn't labeled as a martyr quite yet, but people were already considering him to be so. For example, by February of 1649, a month later, it was written in the Common Book of Prayers that Charles was an innocent, suffering king who was walking in the footsteps of his savior to his own Calvary at Whitehall. The people who supported the monarchy believed that King Charles I was sent by God, again, this idea of divine right, to not only govern the people, but to govern God's church. And that these horrible commoners, these lay people, these Puritans, had put to death a man who was sent by God to protect us. Yes, they were comparing him to Jesus. Now, in my personal opinion, in my personal faith, I don't believe that any human being can stand in between you and God. I think that's probably the heart of the Protestant faith, is that you don't need anybody. You don't even really need to go to church. You can just do your own thing because God is always with you anyway. So I am very much in disagreement of this King Charles I, who again is one of my ancestors, which is why I laugh, being any more special than any one of us. I totally am able to see that the Church of England was established more as a political thing for King Henry VIII to take total control over his life than a religious one. But nonetheless, after King Charles I was executed, it was rumored that there were a bunch of handkerchiefs that had picked up some of his blood, right? Like people standing in the crowd are pulling their handkerchiefs off and wiping down the blood. Now, apparently when you cut a head off, the blood spews anyway. I know it's gross. I'm glad we don't kill people that way now, but that's what happens. And so there probably were quite a few numbers of these handkerchiefs with his blood on them. And apparently, some of these handkerchiefs started to perform miracles. Wild, right? And I couldn't find that much information on them because this was quite a long time ago. But these handkerchiefs, people were taking them home and they were healing them. So this added a lot of folklore and legend to the idea that King Charles I was like a modern day Jesus that had been, you know, crucified for trying to protect the Church of England. Least we remember, though, that this King Charles I was responsible for a lot of deaths up in Scotland because they were Presbyterians. I don't think a real Jesus would be responsible for that many deaths. Do you? And it could just be a simple case of mind over matter. Some of these people could have been so obsessed with the idea that King Charles I was a martyr that they almost willed themselves to heal, thinking that it had everything to do with these bloody handkerchiefs. We can also look at the possibility that these handkerchiefs were mere propaganda started by the royalists. Like maybe they wanted to try to convince people that they needed to bring the royalty back because look, all these miracles are happening with handkerchiefs. We are not immune to propaganda. I mean, hello, our media is pretty much propaganda nowadays anyway. The job of the news is to hide the news, so there's that. Well, after Oliver Cromwell died and the government of England decided to bring back his son, who became King Charles II, we know from our video on Oliver Cromwell that King Charles II went buck wild on all these people who had hurt his father. Again, that's why Oliver Cromwell was dug back up and his head ended up traveling around England for like 300 years. Again, video is listed below if you missed it. But after the monarchy was brought back, that is when his son made, legally in the Church of England, made his old dad a martyr, like a saint. He was canonized on the 19th of May, 1660. So now it's not just King Charles I, but it's Saint King Charles I. So the High Church Anglicans hold the 30th of January as Saint King Charles I's feast day. Now, we don't really have feast days in the Protestant Church, so I'm not really familiar with what happens on these particular days, but the day of his execution became like the day where the Anglican Church celebrated their martyr, Saint King Charles I. As we moved into more modern times, in the year of 1859, the Church of England did remove a lot of these services revolved around Saint King Charles I from their common book of prayer. When this happened, a cult formed. There were people within the Church of England, especially within the Tory group, which from what I understand, the Tories of England are like our Republicans. They're more the elite, the wealthier, people in society, although the Republican Party here in America is changing and the Republican Party is turning out to be more the party for the people. But those were the people that were starting to form in this cult after it was taken out of their society. It makes sense, right? These are the 1%. These are the people who would be loyal to the monarchy. They're probably some of them distant cousins to the monarchy. And so they are going to want to keep their King Charles canonized and celebrated as almost superhuman. This cult became so large that by 1894, they created a society. Society of Saint King Charles I, the martyr. And from what I understand, this cult is still alive and well. Now, there is a legend that when King Charles I was about to be executed, that the Puritans told him if he got rid of the higher ranking bishops within the Church of England, they would let him live. And King Charles I refused, so therefore he was executed. This to me is huge. This to me explains why there is still a cult based around this monarch. You see, the bishops were the ruling elite of the Church of England. They're the ruling elite of the Catholic Church as well. The Protestants, along with the revolution that would end up forming the American Revolution, wanted all humanity to be equal in God's eyes because all of humans are equal in God's eyes. No human is more important than another human. And the elites who cling so tightly to this cult either have grown up in maybe a Luciferian family or a satanistic family where they do believe that there is divine right, where they do believe their bloodlines are special, or they're looking for more communistic ways of governing a church or a government, which again would go back to the elite, because in a Marxist society, it's only the elite who survive. One of the most famous members of this cult is Lord Nicholas Charles Edward Jonathan Windsor. He is a cousin of the ruling monarch that we have today. So basically, he's related to me as well. And if I could say anything to him, if I could say anything to any of my family members who are still in the royal family, get over yourself. Divine right is bullshit. Nobody should have a king or a queen. Nobody should have a pope. Nobody should have anybody telling them how they can connect with God, because God is within all of us. At our births, we are all anointed with consciousness by God and God alone. All right, guys, thank you so much for sitting through this video. Let me know your thoughts down in the comments below. Had you ever heard of this cult, this society? If you're Episcopalian or if you're a member of the Church of England, let me know if you have heard whispers of like these people who have handkerchiefs of King Charles I that supposedly commit miracles. Let me know. Again, I would love to hear your stories. All right, if you would like to purchase our opening song, there's a link down in below. Thank you again to Josh McKay for doing our music, and thank you to Todd Broderick for helping me get this video up for you guys. I will talk to you soon. Bye.